Are you able to hear me, students, now? Okay. Say yes or no? Okay, fine. So let us start. So let us start today's class. So this class will not be a part of your midterm syllabus. However, this is a further clustering algorithms we will discuss in today's class, which will be useful for your compre exams, and we can have some spare time for your doubts taking in the end. So that's why I have taken today's class, so that in the end we can have some time for your doubt sessions. Okay. So then let us start. So what do you mean by clustering? So we will study some clustering algorithms today. First of all, what do you mean by clustering? Clustering is you are grouping a set of documents into some clusters or subsets. Like whatever documents you find similar, those you are grouping into some group. That is called as a cluster. So cluster is a group of documents which have some similarity and therefore they are grouped together. Right? So now basically what is the characteristic of a good cluster? It should have similar documents. So basically it should be clearly different from the other clusters, but within the cluster the documents should be very similar to each other. Then only they should be grouped together, right? And the groups should be clearly distinct from other groups. So if I say there are some documents within a group or a cluster, then they should be clearly different from other documents which are belonging to the other clusters, right? So we can say that documents within a cluster should be as similar as possible, and documents in one cluster should be as dissimilar as possible from documents in other clusters. Can we say this thing? Because we want a good clustering. So if there is a good clustering, that means the more similar documents are being captured within that cluster. So documents within a cluster should be as similar as possible. That means the intra-cluster distance should be minimum, and the documents in one cluster should be as dissimilar as possible from the documents in another cluster. Right? Right? So this is intercluster distance should be maximum within the clusters, and between the clusters should be maximum, and within the cluster it should be minimum distance, right? So clustering is basically a form of unsupervised learning. Why I say that it's a unsupervised learning? So all of you know what is supervised learning and what is unsupervised learning? Say yes or no? So basically what is unsupervised learning? When we do not have any supervision, that means we do not have any training set available to us, right? So if you do not have any training set or human input available to you for classification, then it is called as, for categorization or classification, then it is called as unsupervised learning. Unsupervised learning means learning from raw data. So basically we group the documents into clusters based on some similarity information between the documents, and that similarity information we capture and we group them, but we do not have any training set available to us which will say that this particular type of documents will belong to this particular cluster. And then when your new document comes, you can use that a classification algorithm to cluster the new document also, but that is not the case in clustering. So it's a kind of a unsupervised learning. So what is the difference between classification versus clustering? Classification is a supervised learning, because in that we have human defined classes, and those are basically your training set, and then we can put this as an input to the learning algorithm, and the training set is basically a set of labeled documents. For those documents which we know the class, they are the training set. So the learning algorithm will learn that which type of documents have been given which type of label or which type of class, and that learning algorithm will actually be useful when a new document comes. So when a new document comes, you apply the classification algorithm to it which you have learned through the training set, and then generate the class of this new document also. That is what we do in classification. So it's called a supervised learning, because you have a training set available to you based on which you learn a classification algorithm, and then you can classify any new document. But in clustering, we do not have any classification algorithm which is already available to you through a training set. So we do not have any training set also, we do not have any classification algorithm also. But what we do is we just see the patterns, the similarity patterns between the documents amongst themselves, and then group them together. Okay? So basically clustering is an example of unsupervised learning, you can say. When you are doing classification, it's an example of supervised learning. Okay. So I will tell you what is clustering and what is unsupervised learning in detail in the next slides. So there can be many ways in which we want the outcome of clustering. Like we say that how many clusters we want in the end, and or otherwise the similarity measure. That means at this particular similarity measure, I want all the clusters. So whatever documents have this particular similarity measure, they should be clustered together. So we could have different ways of influencing the outcome of clustering. So if you see in this example, it's basically having the dots are basically the documents only. So here we are having the dots as the documents. Now from this structure, you can clearly identify that this is one cluster, this is another cluster, and this is another cluster. But just by seeing, you can identify that this is one cluster. However, if you want to design an algorithm for finding the clusters, then you need to have a clustering algorithm, a proper algorithm for clustering that which document should be in one cluster. So the hypothesis of cluster hypothesis says that the documents in the same cluster will behave similarly with respect to a query. So suppose a user is typing a query, then since the documents in the same cluster are similar to each other, so that means they will all satisfy the user's need. That means they will all satisfy the query, right? Because they are similar to each other, they are sharing many common terms. So whenever a query is typed, we want that the terms which are containing, the documents which are containing those terms should be retrieved. And the documents in one cluster are basically similar to each other, so they will be having many common terms. So that means they will all be the answer to my query. Right? So if there's a document from a cluster that is answer to my query, then it is very likely that other documents from the same cluster also answer to my query, because they are similar documents. Right? So this is called as a cluster hypothesis. So why we do clustering now? To improve your recall. Can you tell me why the recall will improve? Suppose you type a query in a search bar and some document is retrieved and that document belongs to a cluster. So we can easily say that the other documents in the cluster will also be an answer to my query, and I can fetch those documents also. So that means just by fetching one document, I know that it is belonging to one cluster, and I can fetch all the documents in that cluster also, and that will be relevant to my query. So I'm improving my recall, the number of relevant documents which are retrieved, I'm improving them because of clustering. So suppose you have a query car, then it will return a document containing car, and suppose that document belongs to a cluster which also contains the documents containing automobile. So then those documents also will be retrieved as an answer, and that is also relevant to my query car, because car and automobile are synonymous, I mean they are related terms. So if a query is matching a document D in a cluster, then all the documents in the cluster will also be an answer to my query. That's how I can improve the recall, the number of relevant documents retrieved. Are you able to get this point? And then now can you say why the speed will improve? Because suppose one query is there and that is not matching a document in a cluster, then the other documents in that cluster will also not match. So you do not need to compare with the other documents also. Once you say that this particular document is not matching my query, then the other documents in the cluster will also not match my query, because they are the similar documents in that cluster. So you need not compare with each and every document, just you compare only one document from that cluster, and that is enough to say that the complete cluster is irrelevant to my query. So you are saving a lot many comparisons with each and every document, because you will just do a comparison with only one document in that cluster and say that this document is not relevant, so the entire cluster is also not relevant. So in this case, some comparisons you are saving. So you can say that you are improving the speed using clustering. Right? So then we have two types of clustering, flat and hierarchical clustering. So what do we mean by flat clustering? It's basically whenever you have the clusters which are independent of each other. So you are partitioning your documents into groups, that means you are generating the clusters, and these clusters do not have any relationship with each other. So they are called as flat clusters. And hierarchical clusters are those clusters which are having a hierarchy and they are arranged in that hierarchy. So one cluster is the parent of some other cluster, and that is the parent of some other cluster, and so on. So like a tree, like a binary tree, you have a hierarchy like a binary tree. So some clusters are the children of a parent cluster, that parent cluster is in turn a child of some other cluster up to the root node. Okay? So an example of flat clustering is k-means clustering. And for hierarchical, we have two types, agglomerative and divisive. Agglomerative is also bottom-up hierarchical clustering, and divisive is top-down clustering. So we'll study them one by one. So let us study the flat cluster. So there are two other categories, hard and soft clustering. So hard clustering means each document belongs to exactly one cluster. For example, in K-means, when you do, it's a flat and hard clustering. Because in K-means, your clusters are independent of each other and each document can belong to only one cluster. But in soft clustering, a document can belong to more than one cluster also. For example, in your hierarchical clustering. So in your hierarchical clustering, one document can belong to more than one cluster because it can belong to itself, its own cluster, as well as to the parent cluster. Because what is hierarchical clustering? It's a tree kind of a structure. So whatever documents are belonging to one cluster, they will also belong to the parent cluster. Right? So a document can belong to more than one cluster in the case of soft clustering. An example is a hierarchical clustering. And also expectation maximization algorithm, which you did in the IBM models, that's also an example. So now let us start with what is flat and hard clustering. So K-means algorithm is a flat and hard clustering example. So what is flat and hard clustering? Given a set of documents D1 to DN, what we want to do is we want to cluster them into a desired number of clusters K, right? So given your documents, you want to cluster them into K number of clusters, right? And such that you have achieved a desired quality of clustering, and that is measured by your objective function. So your objective function says that have you achieved the desired quality of clustering or not. Okay, so what our aim is to minimize the value of this objective function, and this objective function will basically evaluate the quality of your clustering. So the gamma is your objective function, which will tell that what is the quality of your clustering. So the minimization of the value of this objective function means that you are achieving the desired quality of clustering. So as the objective function decreases, that means you are increasing the quality of your clustering. And this objective function is surjective, which means that none of the clusters can be empty. All the clusters should have at least one document within them. This is the meaning of this surjectivity, that all the clusters have to have at least one document. So we will have to partition and create the clusters in such a way that none of the clusters is empty. So your objective function is surjective. This is the characteristic which we say. So I am talking about the objective function. So basically, what it is basically doing, objective function is basically partitioning the documents into a set of K clusters and such a way that we are achieving the desired quality of clustering. So it is optimizing something, means it is minimizing the value such that the quality of clustering is better. An example is the K-means algorithm. It is the best known clustering algorithm. Actually, we generally use it. It's a very common algorithm. It's a default for clustering the documents. And document representations in K-means is done using the vector space model again. So we have already studied what is a vector space model. So in K-means, we are representing the documents in the vector space. And for measuring the distance between the two documents, we use the Euclidean distance or the cosine similarity measure. These two measures we use for doing the using the vector space model, finding the distance. So these two measures we will use. So now let us study what is K-means. So K-means is a hard and flat clustering algorithm, which I just told you. So each cluster in K-means is having a centroid. So first of all, we have different, initially what we do in K-means, we consider that suppose there are n documents and I want to cluster them into k number of clusters. So initially, out of those n documents, any random k documents I choose, and I say that these are the clusters. And so that means initially each cluster contains only one document. Okay. So initially what I do, out of the n documents, I choose any k documents and I say that these are my clusters. Right. And then I will define the centroid of each and every cluster by this formula. So this formula you have already done in the last class in the case of Rocio classification also. What is the formula says? How to calculate the centroid of a cluster? Centroid of a cluster is equal to basically... So basically the centroid of a cluster is equal to mu omega, that means omega is your cluster and mu is the centroid of the cluster. So mu omega is equal to summation over all the document vectors which are belonging to that cluster. So whatever documents are belonging to that cluster, we take the summation of the document vectors, and these document vectors are basically the TF, IDF vectors which are length normalized also. TF IDF weighted vectors which are length normalized. So these document vectors we add for each of the documents in the cluster and then divide it by the total number of documents. Okay. So basically this is an average of the length normalized document vectors belonging to that cluster. Right. This is how we calculate the centroid where omega denotes that cluster. So x is basically the document vector belonging to that cluster. So for all the documents, we add their length normalized TF IDF weighted vectors and then divide by the total number of documents. This will give me the centroid. Now, once I have the centroid, what I will do is, I will take the document vector which I want to cluster. So each of the n documents I want to cluster, right? So I will take the first document which I want to cluster, and then I have k number of clusters with their centroid. So I will calculate the distance of this document vector with the each of the centroids. Okay, so I will calculate the distance of this document vector with each of the centroids, and then whichever centroid it is closest to, that centroid's class, that centroid's cluster, I will assign this document vector to. That means the document vector is closest to whichever centroid, that centroid's cluster is the cluster of this document. This is the reassignment step. And then what will happen after the assignment of every document vector out of the n documents? So now I have clustered all the n documents. Now what will happen? My cluster will change. Initially my cluster was containing of only one document each, right? Now my cluster is containing of many documents because I have assigned each and every document to its correct cluster, right? So now my clusters have changed because they are containing more documents. So now what I do is I recompute the centroid because the clusters are now containing a different set of documents. So that means their centroids will also be different now. So I recompute the centroid now again, and that will be nothing but the average of the new document vectors in each cluster. Okay. So now when I recompute the centroids, now again what will happen? Since I have now recomputed the centroid, now again the centroids have changed. So that means my document vectors may belong to now a different cluster. Because now the centroids are different. So a document vector which was closest to centroid number 1 may not be closest to centroid number 1 now, because it is centroid has changed. Its value has changed, right? So this is the second step is the recomputation step. That means you recompute the centroids. Now when you recompute the centroids, again you have to iteratively go on to assign each document vector to its closest centroid, because now the centroids have changed, right? And this again, when you have assigned the vectors, so now the clusters have changed. So again recompute the centroids and go on doing this process, right? So till when we do we stop doing this process? We stop when we have achieved the desired level of clustering. So basically when we have achieved the objective function as a minimal value, then we stop the process. So basically where do we stop? The termination condition is that the centroids do not change. Other condition could be when the clusters do not change. So we do go on repeating this iteratively until your centroids in two consecutive iterations do not change. Or otherwise you can say that the clusters in two consecutive iterations are remaining the same. So then you stop. And other criteria is when you have your quality of clustering is achieved. So this is achieved by using your objective function, which is given as, so objective function is basically given as, it is also called as a residual sum of squares, RSS. So your objective function RSS is defined as the difference of each document vector within that cluster to its centroid vector and square of that difference, and do it over all the document vectors within that cluster. So this will give me the residual sum of squares error for the kth cluster. And then you do it for all the clusters and add that. So that will give me the residual sum of squares error for all the clusters. So basically what is the meaning? I'm trying to calculate how good my clusters are generated. So if I have generated a good cluster, that means all the documents within that cluster will be similar to each other. That means they will be nearer to the centroid, right? Because if I have generated a very good cluster, that means the centroid will represent the members of its clusters very well. That means each and every document will be having a very less distance with the centroid. So that's why I am calculating this distance. So x minus mu is basically each document within that cluster, I am taking a difference with the centroid of that cluster. and then taking a square. So squared of the differences and do it for each and every document within that cluster. So sigma over, that means the error between the document and the centroid I'm taking, and taking a square of that error and doing a sigma over all the documents within that cluster. This will give me RSS K. And now I do it for all the clusters. So and add that error. So this will give me the RSS for the complete set of clusters. So RSS, residual sum of squares error, is our objective function and our goal is to minimize it. So basically it is the minimum average squared Euclidean distance of each and every document from its centroid. Right? And sigma over all the documents within that cluster. So if you have achieved the minimal object value of this objective function, that means your clustering is very good. So this is what is the algorithm which I was just explaining. You have x1 to xn number of documents and you want to cluster them into k number of clusters. So initially what you do is select randomly the seeds. Seeds are nothing but the initial set of clusters. So initially you select any k documents from each of these, from these n documents, initially you select any k documents. Okay. Now when you select these k documents, since they, you designate them as sk clusters. So S1 is one cluster, S2 is another cluster, and so on. So each of these clusters is containing only one document now, initially. So since each cluster is containing only one document, the centroids will be the same as the document itself. Because there's only one document, so the centroid of one document is the same document itself, right? So that's why for k is equal to 1 to k, you are having your centroids as the same as the document itself, right? So initially you have SK number of clusters and the centroids are mu k, right? Now what you do is, for every cluster, you want to find out the new cluster basically. So for every k is equal to 1 to k, you want to find out its new clusters, omega k. So what, how you have to do? You have to pick up each and every document from 1 to n, and then you have to see whether that document is belonging to which cluster. Which cluster? How you will find out? By finding the distance of this document vector with the centroid of that cluster, right? So for so that's why for n equal to 1 to n, so you are choosing the xn document. That means suppose you are choosing the document number 1 and now you are trying to find out that which cluster it belongs to. So how you will find out that thing? You have to take a difference of this document vector with the centroid vector of each and every cluster. So there are k number of clusters, so this you will do it with each and every cluster mu k. And then whichever cluster's centroid is having the minimum distance with xn, that document, that is the cluster to which you have to designate this xn. So let us say the minimum distance comes out for the cluster j. Let us say the minimum distance of xn comes out with the centroid mu j of the jth cluster, right? So this statement means that the minimum distance comes out for the cluster number j. Right? So that means omega j is the cluster. So you will assign the document xn to the omega j cluster. So this step is doing the assignment of the document vector to the cluster which is belong, which it belongs to. Right? Okay? So after, so then next you process for the second document also, you do the same thing because it's an iteration. So this step will do for all the documents, it will try to assign it to the correct cluster. Right? So after your 9th step, you have assigned all the documents to their correct cluster. Now once you have assigned the documents to their correct cluster, so the clusters have changed, omega k has changed now, so you have to recompute the centroids also. So you do it for each and every cluster, you recompute the centroid. So that's why these two steps. So here you are trying to recompute the centroids. So basically, how you will recompute the centroids, mu k is equal to 1 by number of documents in omega k, that means in the kth cluster how many documents are there, and then take a sigma over length normalized TF IDF weighted document vector over all the documents in that cluster omega k. And this you do it for all the clusters. So that means you have now found out the new centroids for each of the clusters. Now once you have found out the new centroids for each of the clusters, so you will return that mu1 to mu k, which is the new centroids, to the algorithm again, and it will go on iteratively processing these things. So these new centroids will be fed to the algorithm again. So now your new centroids will be mu, this mu k will be now whatever you have returned from here. Okay, and then this will go iteratively, and when it will stop when you have reached the desired quality of clustering, or otherwise it will stop when in the two successive iterations your clusters generated are not changing. That means your clustering has become stable. clustering has become stable and centroids are also not changing, at that point of time you will stop. So that means your clustering has become stable, you have converged. Okay, so this is a termination condition. Giving an example of this thing, so just see the example. Here you have the documents and you have initially two clusters containing only one document each, and these are the centroids also. So now what you want to assign the document vectors to their correct cluster, right? So there are only two clusters and you want to assign each of the documents to its correct cluster. So you will, so whichever it is closest, so if this document is there, it you want to classify it, so you will calculate the distance to this centroid as well as to this centroid, and whichever is lower you will classify it to that particular centroid cluster. So like this we have created new clusters. This is, these all documents belong to this cluster and these all documents belong to the second cluster because they were closer to that centroid, right? So this is the assignment of documents which we have done in the first iteration. Now once we have assigned the documents, since the clusters have changed, so you recompute the centroids. So you have recomputed the centroids. So when you recompute the centroid, you see now the centroid becomes there, this and this. So that means the centroid was earlier this and this, and it has shifted here and this has shifted here. So there is a recomputation of the centroid and which makes the centroid to shift in the first iteration, and it's a large shift actually. And this you continue. So once you have recomputed the centroids, that means your classes will again be changing, because the documents will now be assigned to the new documents will now be compared with the new centroid. So they can belong to different clusters. So now you again reassign, then you again recompute the centroids and go on until you converge. So this figure is basically after convergence, after 9 iterations. So after 9 iterations, we found that this particular clusters got stable. Okay, so this is the final centroids which we reached, and these are the final clusters which we got. The plus ones are the documents in one cluster, and zeros are the one documents in another cluster. So if you see the last figure, this is the movement of the centroids. In the first iteration, the centroids were shifted by drastically. That means you shifted from here and you shifted from here to here. But in the successive iterations, the centroids have lesser movements. They are moving only by a small amount. Right? Why this is? Because the convergence is happening. Because in each iteration, you are actually converging to a better clustering. So if it's a better cluster, then the next iteration the centroids will shift lesser. Right? So when you converge, finally the centroids won't shift from their place because it's the best clustering possible. So that's why when you have iterations, initial iterations, the centroids will shift drastically, and then they will their shifting distance will reduce. They will reduce shifting, and finally they will converge so that they won't shift in the successive iterations. Right? So this is another example which you can see, that you have a set of points to be clustered. So initially you randomly select two documents as two clusters, and there are the centroids also. So now you want to assign each of the documents. So you assign the points to the each of the documents to their closest centroid. So this becomes one cluster and this becomes another cluster. So you have assigned. So you designate class 1 and cluster 1 and clusters 2. So these documents you are assigning as cluster number 1 and these documents are assigning as cluster 2. So that's how you have named this 1 and 2. Right? So after you have assigned, so now the clusters have changed. So now you have to recompute the centroid. So earlier centroids were this. And now when you recompute using the new clusters, you will get the recomputed centroid as this and this. So that means it's a drastic shift from here to here and from here to here. Now since your centroids have changed, again you have to recompute, reassign the documents. So when you reassign the documents, so now your clusters have changed. So some documents are coming now in another cluster and some documents are coming now in this cluster. So that is how you have assigned 1 and 2. 1 means the first cluster, 2 means the documents belong to the second cluster. Now again, once you have assigned, you recompute the centroids. And when you recompute the centroids, because now the clusters have changed, so you have to recompute. So now the centroids again shift from here to here and from here to here. Then again your centroids have again changed, right? So now you have to again reassign. So when you reassign, now you are having these clusters. So your assignment gives you these clusters. So now again you recompute the centroids, Now again the centroids have shifted, so you have to go on for a further iteration. So you assign again, and then you again do the computation, and then this is again shifting, the centroids are again shifting, so one more iteration. So you again assign, and then you again recompute. Now once you recompute, the again shifting, so again reassign, and then recompute the centroids. But now when you recompute, here they are not shifting. The centroids are not shifting here. Okay, so when you here when you recompute, the centroids stop shifting. That means in the two successive iterations, in the previous iteration and the next iteration, the centroid positions are not changing. Since they are not changing, that means you have reached a convergence point. Okay, that's how you do. So when you have reached the convergence point, this is the centroid, final centroid, and the classes are also final. So this is your final centroids which you have reached, which are not shifting now in the successive iterations, and this is your final assignment. This is how you get the clustering. Okay, so that I will explain how many random clusters do we need to select initially. That I will explain. So what are the termination conditions for a k-means algorithm, k-means clustering? You can say that you fix number of iterations. You can say that after a fixed number of iterations, I will stop. This could be one criteria. That suppose I say that I will do only iteration wise. So after 10 iterations, I will stop. Whatever is the quality of clustering obtained, that is sufficient for me. So you can have a termination condition as a fixed number of iterations. You can have also the better cut termination condition would be that the centroid positions are not changing in two successive iterations. So if the centroid positions are changing in two successive iterations, then I say that this particular then I keep on iterating. Okay, so when the centroids do not change, that is the termination condition, and the document partitions will also not change because the clusters will become stable, right? This is another terminating condition. Other terminating condition could be when the RSS falls below a threshold. So when you have achieved the desired quality of clustering, then your objective function has reached to a minima. That means your RSS has reached to a minima within a threshold. So you can fix a threshold, and you can say that your RSS, when it reaches that threshold, then you achieve the desired quality of clustering, so you will terminate. Okay? So these could be the termination conditions. And k-means is always guaranteed to converge because RSS is nothing but the sum of squared distances between the document vectors and the closest centroid, and it decreases during each reassignment and recomputation step. So RSS is decreasing at each step. Okay, so finally it will converge to some point because it's a monotonically decreasing function, and it's a finite set basically. So after a finite number of iterations, it will converge finally. So that's why your k-means is guaranteed to converge and generate the clusters, because RSS is a monotonically decreasing function. However, we do not guarantee optimality. So convergence does not mean that it will generate the best clusters. It does not mean that it will generate the best clusters, because it depends upon the seed choice. So where you are starting the clustering, the documents which you are choosing as the starting point of clustering, as your initial clusters, on that it will depend how your quality of clustering is there. Okay. So if you are starting with a bad set of seeds, bad set of starting clusters, then your resulting clustering can be bad also. So convergence does not mean that we will get the best clustering, because in every k-means application, you need to understand that what are the seeds with which you are starting. So because if you see this example, suppose in this example, if you see you are having B and E suppose as initial seeds. Now when you see B and E as initial seeds, if you start with B and E as a seed, that means they B and E are your centroids. So you converge to which clusters? So how you generate the clusters? So you will take one document and see which cluster is closest centroid. So if you see A is closer to B or E. A is closer to B, so it will be clustered into B's cluster. Now if you see D is closer to B or E. D is closer to B or E. So D is also closer to E. D is closer to E. So that means D will belong to E's cluster. Now if you see C is closer to B or C is closer to E. C is closer to B because E, it is diagonal, no? So C is closer to B. So that means these will belong to one cluster. And then if you see F is closer to E. So that means it will belong to E's cluster. So these are the two clusters which you have generated, ABC and DEF, right? Now suppose you change the seeds. So now your seeds are this, D and F. Suppose your seeds are D and F. Now what? Now you see A is closer to D, so it will be in the D's cluster. So B is closer to D or F. B is closer to D or F? B is closer to D. So that means again it will also be classified into D's cluster. Then if you see E, E also will come into D's cluster. Then if you see C, C will come into F's cluster. So you have generated this clusters. A, B, D, E and C, F. Right? So basically the clustering is different if you have a different seed choice. So in case you have B and E as your seeds, then your clusters are A, B, C and D, E, F. In case you have D and F as your seeds, your clusters are different. So, in case you have started with a bad seed choice, then your clusters can be horrible, right? So, convergence will be there, clustering will be generated, but it does not guarantee that your desired quality of clustering is achieved, because it depends upon the seed choice, right? So, I am giving you one example here, and then you have to tell me that what are the clusters generated. So, these are the 5 documents, 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. And the number of clusters is 2 which I want to cluster. I want to cluster these 5 into two clusters. So now, and suppose I say that 4 and 5 are my seeds initially. So 4 and 5 are my two clusters, the initial clusters. Now you tell me which document will be classified into which cluster. Pick up document number 1 and now tell me it is belonging to 4th cluster or cluster of 4th document or cluster of 5th document. Whichever it is closer. And you have to use Euclidean distance as the distance metric. So Euclidean distance means the distance between 1 and 4 and 1 and 5. So distance between 1 and 4 is less. So you will classify that 1 to 4. Now you see the second document, it is also having lesser distance to 4. So second also will be classified into the 4th cluster. Into the document of document number 4th cluster. And third also. And 4th document is also classified into the document number 4 cluster. So finally you will get 2 clusters. 1, 2, 3, 4. And the 5th document will be having its own cluster only. Right? So after step 1, you have centers 4 and 5. So cluster generated would be 1, 2, 3, 4 is in one cluster. And 5 is in another cluster. Right? Now since your clusters have changed, so recompute the centroids. Centroids here you just assume that you are just taking the average. So so you are just taking the average of the clusters. You assume that is the centroid. So you take the average of 1, 2, 3, 4, that will give you 2.5. And you take the average of 5, that is 5 only. So now you have got the new centroid. So again recalculate the document. For each of the documents, you recalculate which belongs to which cluster. So now when you recalculate, what will happen? So 2.5 is my new centroid and 5 is my another centroid, right? So now what will happen? So 2.5, so now which document? So now 2.5 is my another one cluster centroid and 5 is my another cluster centroid. So you have to take up 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 each document and see which it belongs to. That means you take up the first document, so 1 is closer to 2.5 or 5? 1 is closer to 2.5, right? So now your cluster would become belong to the first cluster. Then you see the second document, its distance with 2.5 is 0.5 only and with 5 it is 3. So that means again 2 will belong to the first cluster. Then you see 3, 3's distance with the first cluster centroid is less or with the second cluster centroid is less. Again with the first cluster. So you will classify 1, 2, 3 as belong to the first cluster. Now if you see 4, the distance of 4 with 2.5 is 1.5 and 4 with 5 is 1. So this distance is lesser. So 4 will get classified into the second cluster. So that's why you will get these two clusters. Right? Now again the clusters have changed. So you recompute the centroids. Take the average of the 2. So you take the average of this 1, 2, 3, you will get 2. And you take the average of 4 and 5, you will get 4.5. Now again the centroids have changed. So you again recompute. When you again recompute, what will happen? You will get the new clusters as, because 1 is closer to 2. 2 is also closer to 2. And 3 is not closer to 2. 3 is also closer to 2 because it is having a 1 distance and this is having 1.5. So 1, 2, 3 are again in one cluster and 4 and 5 are again in the second cluster only. So now since the clusters are not changing, the centroids will also not change. So this is the convergence step. Because now if you see in the next iteration, the centroids will again be 2 and 4.5 only. So in step number 3 and 4, centroids won't change and clusters also are not changing. That's why you have converged. So this is the final set of clusters that you have generated. Very simple. Right? Now you go on for another example. Now we go on for another example. So let us say you have this set of documents and you want to cluster them into two clusters and document number 1 and 3 are chosen as your initial seeds. So what you do? So you first of all generate the TF-IDF weighted vector and normalized vectors for document number for all the documents basically, but it is written use TF without IDF and normalization. So you drop the normalization step, drop the IDF weighting also, just use TF weighting because it's written in the question like this. And use the Euclidean distance to find out the distance between two documents. Right. So now you generate the matrix for document number 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. So what is your dictionary? Your dictionary is containing of only three words, fly, eagle and go. Fly, eagle and go. Only three words. So you generate the document vectors. So for document number 1, what is the term frequency of fly? This you all know how to do it. So I am not repeating it again and again. For document number 1, what will be the TF vector? We have to consider only TF without IDF and normalization. So that will be my final vector. So for document number 1, fly is coming once, eagle is coming once and go is not coming. So its term frequency is 0. For document number 2, the go is coming once, eagle is coming once and fly is also coming once. For document number 3, eagle is coming twice and fly is coming once and go is not coming. So it will be 0 term frequency. For document number 4, go and fly. So that means fly will be 1 frequency and go will be 1 and eagle is 0. For document number 5, go and eagle. So go and eagle and this, fly is 0. So like this you will generate the term frequency matrix and this is your final matrix because you have to not do IDF, not do normalization, right? Now your initial clusters are document number 1 and document number 3, right? So these are your initial clusters, document number 1 and 3. So now, and these are your final length normalized TF IDF weighted vectors. So now, for each other document, number 2, 4 and 5, you find out to which cluster it belongs. Document number 1 cluster or document number 3 cluster. So how you will find out this distance? So you will take document number 2 and find out its distance with document number 1 and document number 3. Because they are the centroids now, right? So how you will do? How you find out the distance between two vectors? It's written you have to use Euclidean distance. So you use the Euclidean distance between 2 and 1. So between document number 2 and 1, you calculate the Euclidean distance. So first of all, you see the difference between the components. So Euclidean distance is under root of 1 minus 1 square, this 1 minus 1 square plus 1 minus 1 square plus 0 minus 1 square, right? And under root of that, right? So under root of I am trying to calculate the distance between document number 2 and the document number 1, right? So now document number 2 and 1, the components are 1, 1, 1, 1 and 0, 1. So under root of 1 minus 1 square plus 1 minus 1 square again and then plus 0 minus 1 square, right? So this will give me 1. Finally, it will give me 1, right? So this will give me a 1. Now you calculate the distance between document number 2 and document number 3. So between document number 2 and 3, if you calculate the Euclidean distance, it will be under root of 1 minus 1 square plus 1 minus 2 square plus 1 minus 0 square. Right? This is the Euclidean distance between document number 2 and 3. So this comes out to be 1 minus 1 square is 0, 1 minus 2 square is 1. And this also 1. So under root of 2. So you will get here under root of 2, which is nothing but 1.414. Right? So which is greater distance? Distance of document number 2 to with 1 is greater or distance of document number 2 with document number 3 is greater? The distance of document number 2 with 3 is greater. Right? Because 1.414 is greater than 1. So that means document number 2 will be classified into the cluster of document number 1 because it is having a lesser distance with document number 1's cluster. Right? So that means document number 2 will be classified to the cluster of document number 1. Likewise, you can classify for the other documents also. For example, you can pick up the fourth document and then find out whether the fourth document is closer to document number 1's cluster or document number 3's cluster. Right? You can do like this, right? So then when you calculate, then 4 will get assigned to some document number 1's cluster or document number 3's cluster depending upon the distance. And then fifth also document, for the fifth document also you do the same thing. So now after the first iteration, you will get the revised clusters for document, you will get the revised clusters basically. Now once you get the revised clusters, you will have multiple documents in the first cluster and multiple documents in the second cluster. So you take the centroid. So how to take the centroid? You already know you have to add the document vectors. You have to add each and every component of the document vector. Suppose I say document number 1 and 2 are belonging to one cluster. So how to take the centroid? You take 1 plus 1 as the addition of this, then 1 plus 1 as the addition of this, and 0 plus 1 as the addition of this. So you'll get the sigma over all the document vectors and then divided by the total number of documents. So suppose there are only 2 documents, so divided by 2. That's how you calculate the centroid. Now once you have the centroids, new centroids for each of the clusters, so now you pick up all the 5 documents and then calculate the distance of each of the 5 documents with the 2 centroids. And then reassign them and find out the new clusters and then go on doing it until you get the clusters as stable. That means they are not changing in 2 successive iterations. Right? So you can practice this question and complete the answer to this question. I have not solved it fully. You can practice it at home. And also you can find out what is the final clusters generated. Right? So in the question it will be given to you which type of weighting you have to use. You have to use TF-IDF with normalization or TF without IDF and normalization. In that way only you have to generate the vectors, and then in that way only you have to normalize it, whatever is given to you. Right? Okay. So this was about k-means clustering. Now what is a good clustering basically? As I said, it is having a high intra-cluster similarity and a low inter-cluster similarity. This is a good clustering. But this is not a very quantifiable criteria that what is high intra-cluster similarity and what is low inter-cluster similarity. So this is an alternative for this is that we define some external criteria with respect to a actual classification. So suppose we have a standard data set, for example the routers collection we have, then that collection is telling that which particular documents are classified into which particular categories or classes. So we can pick up that classification and we can see that whether our clustering is correct or not. Just by seeing that which particular documents were classified into which classes, we need not worry about the class labels. We will just see that whether our grouping is correct or not. Because in clustering we do not worry about the class labels. We just worry about that whether they have been grouped correctly or not. Right, that is the goal of clustering. So we will just see whether in the standard data set whatever documents have been labeled with what all classes, that means they are in one group. So those groups are correct or not, we have also generated the same groups or not, that we will check. So we will just reproduce how the documents are divided into groups but not the class labels. So if it is tallying with the standard data set classification, then we can say our clustering is correct. So this is called as an external criteria for clustering quality. However, we have more quantifiable measures of measuring the quality of clustering. So one such measure is purity. Purity means that what do we do in purity? Suppose you have omega is a set of your clusters. Omega 1 to omega k is a set of your clusters. And your classes in which you are, your classes, finally the classes in which they are belonging to, that is C1 to CJ. Let us say, okay, so now what does purity mean? That suppose for the cluster omega k, so for some cluster, all the most of the documents are classified into the class Cj. Okay, so that is assumed to be the correct class for that particular cluster. So what happens, for each cluster, we try to find out that what are the maximum documents classified into which class. Suppose the class Cj is the class in which the most of the documents in that cluster are classified into the class Cj. So then NKJ is basically the total number of documents which are the classified into the class CJ. Okay. So for each cluster omega K, we try to find out the class CJ, which is the most frequent class. Basically, most of the documents in that cluster are belonging to that class. That is the most frequent class. And NKJ is the those number of documents. Suppose in that cluster there are 5 documents and 4 documents are belonging to the class CJ. So NKJ is 4. Okay. So basically the majority class of that cluster. That is the CJ is the majority class of that cluster. Okay. So for the cluster omega k, if the most frequent class is CJ. For the cluster omega k, if the most frequent class is CJ, that means most of the documents are in the class CJ, then NKJ gives the number of documents in that class. So out of 5, let us say 4 are in class CJ, so that means 4 is the majority class. So 4 is the majority class, so 4 gives the NKJ. Right? So basically we define that majority class is the correctly classified. So that means majority class is the correct class for the cluster omega k. That we assume that the majority class is the correct classification. Right? So what you do is, for each cluster you find out the NKJ and add it for all the clusters. Right? So that means the number of correctly classified documents in each cluster you are adding, So sum all NKJs means the number of correctly classified clusters, number of correctly classified documents you are having in NKJ, and this you do for all clusters. So number of correctly classified documents in each cluster you add, and then divide it by the total number of documents in all the clusters. That will give me the purity of clustering, basically, purity of your clustering. So if suppose your omega k is your cluster and CJ is the majority class for that omega k, so that means NK. So if you take the majority class as the maximum occurring class, max J means your class CJ is having the maximum number of documents from omega k, right? So that you do, and that will, this particular expression will give you NKJ basically. NKJ is the number of documents of the majority class, right? And this number of documents in the majority class are the documents which are correctly classified. So you add all the correctly classified documents by taking a sigma over k, that means the number of clusters, and then divide it by the total number of documents in all the clusters. That will give me the purity. Yeah, so this is unsupervised, so you might not know the output classes. You can just say that it is basically, so you just see this example here. Suppose you have these clusters. Classes means they will have some characteristic, right? So suppose you have this example, you will, suppose this is your cluster number 1 and it has got 5 X's and only 1 O. So the majority class is X, because out of the 6 documents, 5 are X's and only 1 is O, right? So this is based on some characteristic. So some characteristic, based on some characteristic, you are knowing that this is which particular document and this is which particular document. These are different documents or these are same documents, right? So out of these 6 documents, 5 are X's and 1 is O. So 5 is your, so X is your majority class because most of the documents are belonging to the class X, right? So your majority class is X, and what is your NKJ? That means the total number of documents which are there in the majority class are 5 out of 6, right? Similarly, you see cluster number 2, you are having 1 X and 4 O's and 1 diamond. So what is the majority class? Because out of 6 documents, 4 are O's. So majority class is O, and that means 4 documents are there in the NKJ. And for cluster number 3, your majority class is diamonds and there are 3 documents in the majority class, okay? So for each of the clusters, you have found out that which is the majority class and how many documents are there in the majority class. And you are assuming that the majority class is your correct classification. So that means all the documents in cluster number 1 should have belonged to X class. All the documents in cluster number 2 should have belonged to O class. All the documents in cluster number 3 should have belonged to the diamond class. But it was not so. So what will be the purity? You add all the correct classifications, that means 5 plus 4 plus 3 divided by the total number of documents in all the 3 clusters. So that cluster number 1 is having 6 documents, 2 is also having 6 documents, and 3 is having 5 documents. So 6 plus 6 plus 5 gives you this 17. So your purity comes out to be 0.71. Okay. So the meaning of this purity is the number of correctly classified documents in each cluster over all the clusters. You add them over all the clusters, that will give you the purity of your classification. Basically, purity of a clustering. So this cluster is having some mixed documents also, because it's having some X's and some O's also. That's why the purity is not 1. Purity always ranges from 0 to 1, so it is not 1 in this case, because you are having some mixed documents in each cluster, right? Okay. So then there is another index which we call as a random index. So that we will study. Just we will take a 5-minute break, and then we will continue with another index for measuring the quality of clustering.